Good morning.
Welcome to First Baptist Weddington. Let's stand and worship. All hail the power of Jesus' name.
Couple things with you, a couple quick announcements. First of all, VBS, we are planning. It is going in full gear for preparation. We're in preparation mode, and this is important. We're doing something different this year, and each year we really have a limited number of spaces, but we especially do this year. So if you are interested in participating in VBS, you want your kids to be a part of it, go on the website. You can do it today and sign up for VBS. Don't wait, because those spots will fill up, so I want to encourage you to take a look at that, and if you want to have your kids be a part of it, sign up soon, if not today, very soon after today. Something else, you see this has been in the bulletin, we've announced it on the screen. We have a Baptist State Convention of North Carolina Missions Conference. It's going to be here in Charlotte, not this Friday, but the following Friday. So we are a cooperating Southern Baptist church. We're a part of the Baptist State Convention. We cooperate. We give to mission causes. This would be not just an informative time, but a fun time, a very spiritual time, if you are interested in being a part of that. That's something that I know we have a heart for as a church, but many times I think we don't take that step to go to these events. When we do, I hear great things. I get great feedback of how it was an enjoyable experience. People learn things. And let me just encourage you, this is something where It's at Hickory Grove, so it's not right near our church, but it's not like it takes a full day to get there. Look at that, pray about that, but also, if you're at all interested, I would encourage you to make the effort to go and be a part of this. If you have other questions, if you want to know more about this, talk to David Lau. He's kind of spearheading this event for us. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, thank you so much for this day. Thank you, Lord, for who you are. Father, we praise you. Lord, you are the only true God. We thank you, Father, for who you are and for what you've done, for what you've done in terms of creating us and redeeming us through Christ. Lord, this morning we want to lift him up. We want to lift our eyes and our hearts to him. And so we ask, God, that you would keep out any distractions, that you would give us the focus and the energy to worship you and to do it rightly. Father, we thank you for all the many things that you're doing in our midst. We pray for VBS. We ask that you would help it as those that are involved and have already committed, that you would encourage them and bless them. And Lord, call out other workers. We thank you for the opportunities to minister to the families around us. We pray, Lord, that you would bring many. We pray, Father, that the gospel would be taught clearly and that lives would be changed for eternity through that ministry. Father, we thank you for the many missions things that we're doing, the ministries throughout our state. Father, we ask that you would encourage us to become more aware and to get more involved. We thank you for the opportunity to give and to give generously. And we pray that you would use those funds to spread the gospel throughout our state. Lord, we want to ask for you to change us today so that we'll leave here a people that's even more in love with you and more excited about Christ and the gospel. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Stand and worship with us.
I cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his knee. My Savior rose, that cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in tears, they laid him down in Joseph's tomb, the entrance sealed by heavy stone. Messiah still and all
we'll sing your praise.
rising sun shall pierce the night, and I will rise among the saints, my gaze transfixed on Jesus' face.
Pastor Sam Roach. Thank you for joining us via live stream for our morning worship service at First Baptist Church of Weddington. We are located at 348 Providence Road South in Weddington, North Carolina. We fulfill the great commission of making disciples by loving God and others, growing in fellowship, study, and prayer, serving joyfully, and going out to share the gospel. Well, I'm glad you have joined us via live stream. If you live in the Charlotte area, I want to invite you to join us in person this coming Sunday. We have small groups, what we call Bible fellowship classes, for all ages that meet at 9:30 a.m., followed by our morning worship service at 11 a.m. So if you live here in Charlotte, I hope you will join us here at First Baptist Weddington this coming Sunday. If you live in another area, I want to encourage you to please find a Bible teaching church that you can attend in person. If you're not physically able to attend church in person, my hope and prayer is that this live stream ministry will bless you and glorify God in your life.
Right.
Please turn in your Bible to the book of 1 Thessalonians. 1 Thessalonians, we're going to begin in chapter 2, verse 17 this morning. I don't know, many of you may be familiar, some of you may be familiar with an author by the name of Tom Clancy. He's written several books, I don't know how many. He may still be writing, I don't know, is he? But in any event, he wrote a book in 1989 called Clear and Present Danger. This is a book which was made into a movie with Harrison Ford and Willem Dafoe, so it's a pretty good flick, but really good book. And the main character is Jack Ryan. He's the main character in many of his novels. And Jack is the acting deputy director of intelligence at the CIA. And what he doesn't know is that his colleagues, superiors, including the president, have started this covert war in Colombia because of the clear and present danger that the Medellin cartel poses to U.S. national security. When we look to 1 Thessalonians in this text today, Paul is writing to the church there about the clear and present danger that they would fall to Satan's attacks. Now, he's praying for them. They are believers, but the danger is still real. Let me just put it on the table at the very outset in case you're wondering if you are truly in Christ. The Bible teaches that the devil can never snatch you away out of his hand. We call that the eternal security of the believer. Yet, there's still a danger for us as Christians that we would fall to Satan's attacks. And that seems to be in view here in this letter to the Thessalonians. It's true for them, and it's also true for us. And we need the inseparable safeguards of true faith and true community to survive. That teaching is implicit in this section of the letter. We begin in verse 17 and see that we can expect opposition when we live the Christian life. Paul writes to the church in Thessalonica, "But since we were torn away from you, brothers, for a short time, in person, not in heart, we endeavored the more eagerly and with great desire to see you face to face, because we wanted to come to you, I, Paul, again and again, but Satan hindered us. For what is our hope or joy or crown of boasting before our Lord Jesus at his coming? Is it not you? For you are our glory and joy. Therefore, when we could bear it no longer, we were willing to be left behind at Athens alone, and we sent Timothy, our brother, and God's co-worker in the gospel of Christ, to establish and exhort you in your faith, that no one be moved by these afflictions. For you yourselves know that we are destined for this. For when we were with you, we kept telling you beforehand that we were to suffer affliction, just as it has come to pass, and just as you know, for this reason, when I could bear it no longer, I sent to learn about your faith for fear that somehow the tempter had tempted you and our labor would be in vain." We'll spend more time in this section than the other points this morning. There's more text there. This is really an easy letter to understand. It's not difficult. We don't know all of the details, all of the reasons why Paul says what he says for certain, but we can piece a lot of it together when we go back to the book of Acts. Especially Acts 17. We learn there that Paul and Timothy and Silas or Silvanus, they plant a church in Thessalonica. It tells us in Acts 17 that while Paul was there with his colleagues, that they encountered opposition, so much so the Jews were so jealous. There was a great uproar in the city. Paul may have been hiding, his co-workers may have been hiding, but his host, Jason, and some others, they're arrested. They have to make bail. They make bail and they're released. Maybe part of the condition of the bail is that Paul and his friends would never go to the town again and never preach the gospel of Christ. We don't know for sure. What do we know about this city, the city of Thessalonica? It was a major political, philosophical, economic center. The Via Egnatia ran through the city, and then just to the west of the city was the north-south trade route. It was a free city. It had favor status in the Roman Empire. And so it was exempt from taxation and other things. That may have been part of the reason that Paul was so unwelcome there, because if not the Jews that were opposed to, to this preaching of Christ than just the Roman or the Thessalonians that were not Jewish, but they didn't like this talk of another king. Paul's preaching this royal theology, and that may have threatened the favored status that the city had. And this was a city that was, it was deep in pagan idolatry. It had the Greco-Roman pantheon, all of those false gods that they paid tribute to, gods that they would offer sacrifices to in hopes that that god or those gods would then favor them. But they never knew what was going to happen because these gods were capricious. They could be angry for no reason at all. It was also a place where the emperor cult was big. And so they worshiped the Roman emperor, many of them. And so there was pressure on these Christians in Thessalonica to conform. To conform to this pagan religion where there was sexual immorality involved. To conform to the Roman emperor cult where, come on, just a little pinch of incense to the emperor. Why won't you do that? That they would be seen, the Christians that would refuse to worship the emperor, to be involved in this pagan idolatry, they would be seen as unpatriotic or a threat to this favored status that they had. So that was going on. Paul writes to them about questions. We'll get to this later in other chapters about the coming of the Lord. There was a question that seems to be in many of their minds. Well, what happens to those Christians that have died? Will they miss the return of Christ? And so Paul wants to teach them about this and correct them. But he also wants to pick up two other major themes in this letter, address two main areas. Number one is this idea of suffering. The idea of being persecuted while you're a Christian. They endured some of it, but they probably thought this will subside after a while. Well, it continues. They're still persecuted. There's still affliction. And so they have questions about this. The other question they have is, Paul, why did you leave so quickly? And just like that question, why haven't you returned? And so Paul wants to answer this in the opening chapter. In chapter 2, Paul gives an apologetic of his ministry, their ministry while they were there. Now he's going to give a defense of his ministry in terms of why he is away, why he hasn't been back. It's not that he hasn't tried to come back. It's not that he hasn't wanted to come back. What does he say? He says in verse 17 that they were torn away. He didn't want to leave them so early. That's a Greek word there. It's apa orpha nidso. It means to be orphaned. It means to be orphaned. It's used in the figurative sense. And it's not that Paul is now switching his metaphors. Remember in chapter 2, he described himself and his colleagues as a caring, gentle mother, nursing mother, and a concerned father. He's not saying now that he's the child or they're the children and the church are the parents, but in this time and in the Roman world, to be orphaned, it could happen both in terms of the children and the parents. So parents could be orphaned. That's what Paul's talking about. This idea of being figuratively orphaned, torn away. If you ever read Charles Dickens' works, you'll understand that he is a master in understanding the depth of human relationships and the pain that's often involved in human relationships. Oliver Twist is a great example of that, where you have the main character who is an orphan, but in most, if not all, of his works, he just shows how painful that can be in many of our human relationships. And maybe we haven't experienced being orphaned, something that severe, but each of us have been separated from loved ones at times, and we know that's painful. We know that that hurts. And Paul is talking about this in the extreme. He's trying to let them know, I do care. I do have concern for you. I didn't want to leave you like I left you. I've been trying to come back. He goes on and he talks about that in verse 18. He says, but Satan hindered us. Egkopto is the Greek word. It means to make progress slow or difficult, hinder, thwart. It's a military term. Armies would put things in the pathway of opposing armies. They'd destroy the roads so it would be make it impossible for those opposing armies to travel, to pass. And Paul's saying, that's what happened with my situations, with our situation. We wanted to come back to you, but But Satan hindered us. He thwarted us. He stopped us. He doesn't say how that happened. He mentions Satan twice in this passage that we're looking at this morning. I think it's important to note two things. First of all, Satan is real. He is a real adversary. He was an adversary to Paul and to his companions. He's an adversary to Christians today. He is our enemy. Doesn't say exactly how Paul was hindered or thwarted. Doesn't say what Satan did. But Paul sees behind a lot of these obstacles in terms of advancing the gospel, which he's focused on doing, he sees Satan behind this. We can't deny in our modern age, which would laugh at this idea of a spiritual world or a spiritual being, and that's who he is. He's a created being. He's a powerful fallen angel. Our modern world would laugh at that, that well, we believe in Satan. But he's real, and the Bible says he's real. But another thing to keep in view here is that he is not omnipresent. He's not present everywhere. He's not all omnipotent. He's not all powerful. So we don't want to give him more credit than he deserves. But we can see behind things in our culture. We can see behind things in our lives when we're trying to live for Christ. We're trying to advance the gospel as a church. Ultimately, whether it's the devil himself, one of his minions, somewhere there's a satanic force that's seeking to hinder the progress of the gospel, to hinder our lives as Christians as we seek to grow in Christ. He's real. Paul goes on to say in verse 3, let's highlight there, Paul says that he does not want the Thessalonians to be moved by these afflictions. The NIV will translate that trial or trials. He doesn't want the Thessalonians to be moved. He doesn't want them to think that this is something that should move them off the mark. His trials or their trials. His afflictions or their afflictions. I like the way the NIV application commentary defines afflictions or trials. It defines it this way: opposition or persecution arising from a conflict of beliefs, values, and conduct between the believers and the surrounding culture. Let me just summarize that. Persecutions, conflicts that arise from a difference between the Christian worldview, what Christians believe about the world, their conduct, their values, and the surrounding culture. There's a conflict between what we believe as Christians and how we're to live our lives. There's a conflict oftentimes between what we believe about the truth, what we believe the Bible teaches, and how we seek to live our lives, and how the surrounding culture says we're to live. There's a conflict there. The persecutions, afflictions can arise from that conflict. We experience it, maybe not in the same way that the Thessalonians did. They would have experienced hardship in terms of being ostracized from the community, not being able to do business, maybe in any real sense. Oftentimes, we don't face that degree or that type, but we do face afflictions, trials as Christians. Verse 5, Paul, again, he's going to mention chapter 3, verse 5. He mentions the devil again. He calls him the tempter. He had fear that somehow the tempter had tempted you and our labor would be in vain. Again, not that if you are in Christ that you will fall away, but somehow the tempter, he doesn't say how, would tempt the Thessalonians and their labor would be in vain. Paul's labor, Timothy's, Silas's labor, that they would somehow get off the mark. They'd be moved. They wouldn't be involved in the gospel work. They would disband maybe as a church. It doesn't say specifically how. What about afflictions in our lives? Do we experience afflictions as Christians? Let's just give a few examples. Think about this. It's a police officer, and a police officer won't cover for another officer who's done something unethical or immoral. Won't cover for that particular fellow officer. And so now that Christian who won't lie, who won't be deceitful to cover up something that their fellow officer did, now they're not in line for promotion. That hurts their career. What about this? What about a high school student? A high school student where in high school many times, in order to be part of the in crowd, in order to have the right kind of desired status, you have to be involved in in alcohol and or drugs. You have to be participating in that, or sexual immorality. That seems to be part of the in crowd. And if you're not doing those things, then you're kind of put on the outside. What about the teacher who has a student who's failing in that student's work, but the parent wants the teacher to give their child a good grade regardless? Go ahead and just pass little Susie or give little Johnny a good grade. And if the teacher doesn't do that, then the parent's going to be critical, harshly critical of the teacher, trying to do what's right, trying to live out the Christian faith. I think that defines in many ways what's going on here in South Charlotte. It's not that we don't have a Christian culture in name, and we do in reality in many ways. It's not like the afflictions of living in Saudi Arabia, where it's illegal to be a Christian, or much less to even practice Christianity. But there are afflictions here that make it okay to say you're a Christian, to be a Christian in name, but then to live it out, to actually live the way God wants us to live. A lot of times, that's not acceptable. We'll face afflictions on the job, in school, if we try to live that way. Paul's saying, don't be moved by this. We should expect opposition when we try to live as Christians. But it's still not easy, is it? Even though we can expect it, even though that's part of the Christian life, even though it says in Paul's second letter to the church at Thessalonica in chapter 1, verse 5, he says, "This is evidence of the righteous judgment of God, that you may be considered worthy of the kingdom of God, for which you are also suffering." Suffering is part of being a Christian. But it's still not easy. It's still not something that's fun often to go through, and that's why we need to keep the supply lines of faith flowing in both directions. That's what Paul's going to talk about here. We'll see this implicitly taught in verses 6 through 10. "But now that Timothy has come to us from you and has brought us the good news of your faith and love and reported that you always remember us kindly and long to see us as we long to see you. For this reason, brothers, in all our distress and affliction, we have been comforted about you through your faith. For now we live if you are standing fast in the Lord. For what thanksgiving can we return to God for you, for all the joy that we feel for your sake before our God, as we pray most earnestly night and day that we may see you face to face and supply what is lacking in your faith." It's an easy book to understand if we realize what's happened after Paul and Timothy and Silas, they leave Thessalonica quickly. They don't hang around. We don't know why. Maybe Paul feared being imprisoned. It would slow the advance of the gospel. So he and his compatriots, they go over west to the next town, to Berea. And Berea, not only do they face persecution there, but it's some of the Jews from Thessalonica that weren't happy with Paul and his friends. They go to Berea and they start causing problems for Paul and his friends. And so Paul tells Timothy and Silas, "You guys, you hang out here. You continue to do ministry here and meet me in Athens." And so Paul takes off and he goes down to Athens. He sails to Athens, and we know that he has this great time of teaching on Mars Hill. He's discoursing with the philosophers there about the true philosophy, the Christian faith. But he runs into some problems there, so he heads down to Corinth. Now, when he writes this letter, he'd probably been away from Thessalonica for maybe a matter of months. He's writing around maybe late AD 49 to early AD 51. We have that on extra-biblical sources as well as the recordings in Acts, that this is the time frame that he's writing this. And so if we think about that, when Paul writes this letter, Christ has already come to earth. He's lived a perfect life. He's gone to Calvary. He's suffered on the cross. He's been raised from the dead, and he's ascended to the Father's right hand. And the gospel is going out. Paul's teaching about that gospel, and he's advancing the gospel. He's preaching the gospel. And what happens? Eventually, Timothy and Silas, Paul's in Corinth, and he's there for about a year and a half. Timothy and Silas make their way down from Berea, and Paul just can't take it any longer. He misses the Thessalonians. He wants to know, have they been moved because of the afflictions? Are they still walking in the Lord? And so he sends Timothy back to Thessalonica. Timothy gives a good report. He comes back and he tells Paul, yes, they're standing firm. But they have some questions, and there are some concerns about why you haven't been back. And so Paul is addressing this. He addresses it in these verses, and he talks about how he's rejoicing. For now we live, verse 8, if you are standing in the Lord. What a great exclamation of joy. Have you heard of the 1914 Christmas truce? It's so-called Christmas truce in World War I. 5 months after the outbreak of World War I in August, on the dawn of Christmas Day, on the front lines, on the Western Front, there were German troops. They were coming out to no man's land, and the Allied troops thought this was some kind of trick. But they see that these German soldiers, they're unarmed. And they're actually saying Merry Christmas in the tongue of the Allied soldiers. They're hearing this. And so the Allied soldiers, some of them, they stepped out of the trenches and they go and they exchange gifts even with the German soldiers. Things like this happened. It's amazing. And there was even a friendly game of soccer that took place at one of these locations. Maybe dozens, maybe others. As one historian notes, this is like a bright, shining light of humanity in the midst of so much darkness, so much death. World War I wasn't like World War II. It didn't just kind of start ramping up. There were huge casualties just in the opening weeks and months of World War I. But here we see this act of kindness and humanity between these combatants. It shines brightly. And that seems to be what's going on here with Paul. When he gets this good news about the faith of Thessalonians, think about the Apostle Paul. He's been persecuted. He's been beaten. Death is kind of knocking on the door always. And yet he receives good news about the Thessalonians. And it's just a bright, shining light of joy for him. He rejoices. He goes on and says down in verse 10 that he wants to come back and supply what is lacking in your faith. His desire, though, is not just for emotional reasons. He does care for them. He cares for them deeply. But his desire to get back is to teach, to supply what is lacking in the faith of the Thessalonians. He has a concern for them. And he wants to go back and he wants to teach them. Staying with World War I, I've been listening to Dan Carlin's Hardcore History on this, on these podcasts, and he talks about several big battles. You can't cover it all, but one of them is the Battle of Verdun. Maybe you've heard of that. It took place between February and December of 1916. Huge battle. And there are differing accounts about this. Some say that the French repulsed a major German offensive, but others say that this was really more of a German kind of tactic to lull the French army in. In any event, there were huge casualties. Conservative estimates say the hundreds of thousands on both sides, several hundred thousand dead, hundreds of thousands of casualties beyond that. It's a horrible battle. And if you study this and you look at it, on the front lines with the French, they were dug in, and yet the Germans, they had them pinned down. And so when reinforcements came to relieve the front lines, the German guns would just pick off those refreshments. But if the soldiers at the front lines, if they were dying of thirst and hunger, they tried to get back to their camp and get food or water, they too would be picked off. The supply line going and coming was shut off, shut down completely. It was just horrific to hear some of the stories. We need to keep the supply lines of faith going in both directions. I could say it this way. We need to keep the supply lines of the faith going in both directions. That's what's happening with Paul and the Thessalonians. Paul wants to get back to teach them. But he's also receiving from them. He's receiving encouragement. He wants to get back and encourage them. But he's also going to learn when he gets back to Thessalonica. By the way, from what Acts teaches us, God does answer this prayer that they'll pray a little later on. They do make it back to Thessalonica. But think about what it is needed for us as Christians. What is needed for us? We need to be involved in a local church. We need to be with other Christians. That's the way God designed it. We need to be teaching, and we need to be receiving instruction. Paul is so concerned about the Thessalonians being complete in their faith. He wants to supply what's lacking. As Christians, we should never miss an opportunity to grow. If there's ever an opportunity to learn and to grow, we should take advantage of that. And maybe you're not teaching a class, but just by being here, there are times where you can teach others as well. And so that needs to be happening. There needs to be this mutual edification, so to speak. We need to be encouraging one another. We need to receive that encouragement. We need all of those blessings of the Spirit pouring into our lives and then pouring through our lives to others. We need to wake up about this. This is needed. We can't live the Christian life on our own. Can you be a Christian and not be a member of a local church? Yes. But is that God's design? No. He designed it that we would be part of a local church. And I'm so thankful that what we see and what we hear from others is that we do give encouragement. People receive encouragement when they come into the body. We're encouraging others. We're teaching others. We need that, and we need to be giving it away as well. Well, when we do that, here's what's going to happen. As a church and as individuals, we're going to grow in holiness through love until Jesus returns. Paul's going to end this section with a prayer, another prayer. For the Thessalonians, now may our God and Father himself and our Lord Jesus direct our way to you, and may the Lord make you increase and abound in love for one another and for all, as we do for you, so that he may establish your hearts blameless in holiness before our God and Father at the coming of our Lord Jesus with all his saints. This prayer is chock full of great stuff. Let's just break it down by asking four questions. Who, what, why, and when? Who is Paul looking to for the ultimate source and supply for the Thessalonians and for his life? Well, he's looking to our God and Father himself and our Lord Jesus. He's looking to God because God is the ultimate cause. Yes, God works through individuals. He works through us and he works through others. But we need to remember we need to be getting teaching from the Word. We need to be in the Word. We need to be praying. We need to be going to our God and our Father. We need to be going to Christ, relying on the Spirit. We need to be in prayer, looking to God for all things. That's what Paul is doing here. That's what he's reminding the Thessalonians about. And also, this second question, what does Paul ask for? Three things. Number one, in verse 11, the second part, that God would direct our way to you. He wants to go back. He wants to go back to Thessalonica and God. If we look at Acts 19, it seems that the Lord granted his prayer. Second, he asked God to make you increase and abound in love for one another. Jesus says this is the greatest mark of his followers, that we would have love for one another. And that is a protection against the enemy when we love one another, when we show love, when we have love for each other. We're going to mess up. We're going to make mistakes. We're not perfect. There are no perfect people, no perfect Christians. We need to be showing love for one another. We are not each other's enemies. Our enemy is Satan, and we need to remember that, and we need to love one another. But Paul doesn't stop there. He goes on to say the third thing that he asked for, an increase and abound in love for all, as we do for you. Paul says this in other letters, that we're not just supposed to show love to our fellow Christians, but we're supposed to show love to all. We're to have love for the person down the street. We're supposed to have love for that coworker. That person may not act like a Christian. It's not going to be easy for us to love that person at times, but we need to love them. The greatest way we can love someone is to pray for their eternal soul, that they would receive Christ as their Savior, that God would use us as an instrument of his love to them and sharing Christ with them. Paul's saying that Thessalonians, you need to abound in love, not just for each other, not just increase in love for one another, but for all. For all, and that needs to be what we're doing as well. Why? What's the purpose here in verse 13? That he may establish your hearts blameless in holiness before our God and Father. A way to be blameless and holy is through love. That's one of the ways. And that's what Paul is praying for the Thessalonians, that their hearts would be established, that they would be complete, they would be perfected. When? Verse 13, second part, at the coming of our Lord Jesus with all his saints. In every chapter in 1 Thessalonians, Paul mentions the coming of Christ, and this is no exception in chapter 3. This is the parousia. This is the coming. Christ is coming again. Are you ready for that? He is coming again. Have you received Christ as your Savior? Have you personally asked God to forgive you of your sin, turning from your sin to Christ, asking Him to forgive you based on the shed blood of Christ alone? Have you repented of your sin and trusted in Christ? Have you turned from your sin and believed in Him? If not, you need to do that. And if you do that, then you have no reason to fear Christ's coming. If you haven't done that, then you're going to be considered an enemy of God, and you have a great reason to fear. So my encouragement, my exhortation is, don't be found outside of Christ. Receive Him today. He is coming back, and we don't know when. It could be at any moment. Well, there was a Puritan preacher by the name of Thomas Shepherd. He was born in Towcester, England in 1605, and he died in Cambridge, Massachusetts in 1649. He was an English clergyman, but he was silenced twice by the bishop for his nonconformity. Once in 1631, once in 1633. So in 1635, he said, I've had enough. I'm going to head to see the others, the Christians and others that have gone to the colonies. And so he heads over, and he succeeds another famous Puritan by the name of Thomas Hooker at his church in Cambridge, Massachusetts. And Shepherd was a great minister. He had influence not just within his church, not just within Cambridge, but a historian has written that when he died, it was a great loss for all of New England. He was instrumental in founding Harvard College, and he was really the impetus to change the name of the town to Cambridge. He thought when he was pastoring his church, he tells his story because he's preaching through the parable of the 10 virgins. He preaches this message, the parable of the 10 virgins, over several years. He goes through it very slowly. It's about the virgins that some of them are found ready for Christ's return, but several of them are not ready for Jesus when he comes back. Shepherd tells a story. He says, I thought that my congregation, the fact that they'd come to the colonies, they'd no longer face persecution like they did in England, that now they'd be on fire for Christ. But instead, I found really a lot of apathy and even decadence. He told his congregation, he said, look, the Pequot Indian Wars, the division, the conflict that we've gone through as a church body, he said, those are actually blessings from God. They've woken us up. And he exhorts them and he tells them to wage war. There's no room for sloth in the Christian life. Don't let an easier life lull you to sleep. Don't be slothful. We're to wage war against every temptation. I think that's a good word for us. It's not so much the persecution that causes us the greatest temptation to fall by Satan. It's the fact that we have been given so much. We have so much freedom. We have so much opportunity to do so many things. We don't have to fear persecution. We need true faith and true community to survive all of the temptations that come our way, whether it be afflictions or whether it be success in life. In fact, Paul writes to the church in Rome, in Romans chapter 3, verses 3 through 5, we rejoice in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance. Endurance produces character. Character produces hope, and hope does not disappoint. Why? Because the love of God has been poured into our hearts by the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. Father, we thank you that we have the Spirit in us to remind us of your love, to show us how we can love others. Father, we want to be reminded of the ever-present temptation to give in to the difficulties of the Christian life or the easiness of the Christian life that we experience here in South Charlotte. Either way, Lord, we know that we need the inseparable safeguards of true faith and true community to survive. Father, help us to be more committed. Lord, help us to be in your word. Help us to be here encouraging and receiving encouragement and instruction and praying constantly. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. But this is the time in the service where you can respond to that gospel invitation. You can do it right where you're seated. In fact, if you've done it today, we want to rejoice in that. If you've done it previously, but you've never shared it publicly, we want to rejoice in that as well. But here's what we're going to ask you to do. As we have this song of response, we're going to have a couple of our men down front. A couple of our ladies will be seated here. If you have never shared publicly the fact that you've received Christ as your Savior, would you come forward this morning? We want to be here to encourage you. We want to be here to rejoice in that and pray with you. Maybe you know that you are in Christ, but you're looking for a church home, and you want to present yourself for membership here at First Baptist Weddington. You believe the Lord is leading you here. This would be the time to come forward and let us know of your desire. Maybe you've never been baptized, or you were baptized before you were a Christian, and you want to get baptized on the right side of salvation or be baptized for the first time. This is the time for you to come forward. However the Lord is leading, follow Him.
Would you stand?
About a year ago, I found out I was pregnant. It was too soon, and I had decided to terminate my pregnancy. When I pulled up to the abortion clinic, one of the sidewalk counselors slid a pamphlet through the window. I brought this pamphlet inside with me to the abortion clinic, and as I skimmed through it, I realized that I couldn't go through with this. This would be the point of no return for me. It took me about 3 to 4 weeks before I was able to grow the courage to contact the phone number on the pamphlet. I spoke to Vicky, who put me in touch with a love life mentor by the name of Holly, who's been phenomenal and a true blessing to our family. Getting matched up with my mentor has been such a blessing to our family. She threw us an awesome baby shower. She has been so supportive, so encouraging.
Amen, what a great story. And that's the first week of April. April 7th through 13th will be focusing on our week for Love Life Charlotte. I want to share with you one more emphasis this morning. On the announcement slides, you've seen this slide. It says, "Who's your one? Who's your one?" And in the North Carolina Baptist Convention right now, we are talking about that. And I want you to be praying for this strategy, because this is something that Pastor Sam and I and the staff have been talking about. And we want to launch this within a few weeks. But, J.D. Greer, who is the president of the Southern Baptist Convention, says this: it doesn't matter how many churches you plant, how many sermons you preach, how many buildings you build, and I can add to that how many music ministries you have, Sunday school, Bible study groups, children's groups, youth groups. It doesn't matter how much you're that. If you are not intentionally engaging people with the gospel and seeking to transform lives and bring people into the kingdom, if we're not doing that, then we're failing. That's a sobering thought, to think that we can do all this stuff, but if we're not doing that, we're eliminating the Great Commission from our emphasis as a church. And to be called a church, you can't do that. So I think our church and all churches should be focusing on the primacy of personal evangelism, that it's not just something the church does, but it's something that each one of us should do. So what is this about? This campaign is about us selecting one person, praying for just one person that God would lead us to, or that we really have a burden for, to see that person transformed by the gospel. And so what this is about is that for 30 days, you will intentionally pray for that person, praying that that person would have people who would speak the gospel into their lives, or seeing something, or hearing something, or reading something, and then you intentionally seeking opportunities to share your faith with that person. There's a 30-day scripture guide that goes with this, and we will have those in a few weeks when we launch this, that you can take and pray for that person. And it has blanks that you put their name in as you pray for them specifically and opportunities that you would have to share the gospel with them. The goal is to share the gospel. The goal is not for them to necessarily receive Christ, because that's God's work, okay? Success is not us bringing someone into the kingdom. That's God's work. We're simply being obedient to share the gospel and fulfill the Great Commission. So be thinking about that as we launch this in a few Sundays. Let's stand, close our worship this morning by singing a chorus called "Bind Us Together, Lord. Bind Us Together with Love."
Bind us together.